last section today, and we are very happy to have Professor Kenji Fukushima from Melbourne Keio University to tell us about the face diagram of Kenji.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you very much for that kind invitation. I'm very happy to be here again. I came here actually 6 years ago or so. There was a conference about the symmetry in subatomic system. And so today I will talk about phase diagram of QCD. Actually the phase diagram is a very interesting place where you can apply many theoretical ideas like the lattice QCD simulation or holographic description or the effective models. And actually this school is very interesting because I found that there are 4 lectures and 3 of them will cover those techniques that I mentioned, namely the lattice QCD and holographic technique and effective theories, and I cover the phase diagram where you can apply those ideas. Okay, so this is my lecture plan. So today and maybe tomorrow I will talk about QCD phase transitions, and especially the confinement and deconfinement phenomena. Actually, the deconfinement phase transition is it's a very clean system, and the deconfinement phase transition is well defined in field theory. Nevertheless, the full understanding of a deconfinement phenomenon is very, very non-trivial, as I will explain later. Okay, and recently, some very nice understanding is available from the thanks to the development of the lattice QCD technique to measure the gluon and ghost propagators in some particular gauge. And then the next topic I will talk about is the chiral symmetry breaking and restoration in the context of QCD at finite temperature. And the chiral symmetry breaking and restoration, that was the first described by a number using his very famous effective theory, Nam-Yonarazini model. And so still, actually, there are lots of interesting arguments about the chiral phase transition, especially motivated by the relative heavy ion collision experiment. So from time to time, I will mention on the phenomenological motivations, and especially tomorrow, I will introduce some experimental data from the relative heavy ion collision, but I will not go into the data too much. But just to make my point clear, I show some of the selected experimental data. And actually, those experimental data suggest that the large MCQCD could be a very good approximation of a real QCD with 3 colors. Okay? The color number 3 and the infinite number of colors, they may sound very different worlds, but it turns out that the Lazen approximation is a very nice approximation to capture the essential features of QCD phenomena. Okay? And so, in this context, recently some people, the Brookhaven National Lab, some people proposed a very interesting speculation called the photonic matter. Okay? So actually, there were some confusions in the community about the interpretation of this photonic matter, but the basic idea is very simple. And actually, this quantity, this the state of matter is very well defined. That I will explain later, so tomorrow. And in the last part, I will change my main subject to magnetic field and inhomogeneity. And this inhomogeneity is actually driven by the consideration about the ground state in the context of chiral symmetry breaking and restoration. And so nowadays, I think that the inhomogeneity is more favorable than the possibility of the first-order phase transition or the QCD critical point. So this, the importance of this possibility is increasing. And in fact, this inhomogeneity was also found using the holographic QCD model, the best one, that is called the Sakai-Sugimoto model. And so in this context, there are lots of good contributions from a Taiwanese group that I will introduce if I have enough time. But also, the magnetic field is also a very interesting quantity. And actually, in the context of the heavy ion collision experiment, you can easily see that there is a gigantic magnetic field created instantly after the heavy ion collision. And then you can expect some topological phenomena like the chiral magnetic effect and so on. And actually, this topological effect has a big impact to the possibility of the spatial inhomogeneity that I will explain using the Sakai-Sugimoto model if I have time. But I'm afraid that I may not have enough time because I already have 100 slides. And so I will try to go fast, but of course not too fast. So you can anytime interrupt me. So you are encouraged to stop me, okay? At any time. So the first part, QCD phase transitions. Okay. So whenever I talk about the QCD phase diagram, I'm very happy to show this historical phase diagram drawn by Gordon Bem in 1983. Okay. So this is actually a very important phase diagram. And this phase diagram basically led us to the realization of the heavy ion collision facilities like weak or LHC, okay? In the context of the heavy ion collision. Okay? And so here you see this horizontal axis is a baryon density, or in the modern language, this should be a baryon chemical potential. And this vertical axis represents the temperature. And then around the temperature, like 200 MeV. 200 MeV is a very characteristic scale in QCD. This is of order of so-called lambda QCD. Okay? Lambda QCD is a typical scale in QCD appearing in the running coupling constant. So all QCD phenomena should be characterized by lambda QCD. So naturally, the phase transition temperature should be the, comparable to lambda QCD. And also, the baryon density, the chemical potential, typical chemical potential should be something around several hundred MeV or one GeV, okay, the baryon mass scale. Anyway, or in terms of a coke mass, it should be some several hundred MeV. Okay? And then you can expect some kind of a phase transition that you can see several descriptions like deconfinement or chiral transitions or okay, the deconfined quarks and gluons and no hadrons, blah blah blah. Okay, so in this the first part of my lecture, I want to explain these contents. Okay, and so this is one of the most modern phase diagrams, or with lots of conjectures like this and a big question mark. Actually, so I wrote this. I drew this the conjecture space diagram several years ago with Tetsuo Hatsuda when we wrote a review article. And so you can see some inhomogeneous places here and here. And unfortunately, nothing has been confirmed by experiment. So. You know, so this part is very well understood in the high-energy relativistic heavy ion collision. And this part is also very well understood in the context of normal nuclear matter, okay, the nuclear physics. But this part, this phase transition and the critical point, blah, 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 okay, quark-ionic matter, these are all conjectures or speculations. But so now, some ongoing projects in Europe and Japan and Russia, they are going to access probe these regions of the phase diagram using their lower energy heavy ion collision programs. Okay? So in the future, the full exploration of the phase diagram must be the very important subject. Okay?
So what's happening to the
blue part? So these are current superconductors. Okay, so here you can use a perturbation theory, and so you can directly apply QCD calculations to find the
high density, right?
Huh?
That's only at a high density you can use.
Yes, right? yes.
But intermediate density.
Oh, in the intermediate density, so that's why I put a big question mark here. Okay. Actually, I'm also an expert of the current superconductors. Okay. I worked with Krishna Rajagopal, but actually, so the problem here is that the strange quark mass becomes comparable to the film surface, gap energy. Okay, actually, to have a superconductor, you must have a Cooper pairing. Okay, but in QCD, what is more complicated than a usual superconductor is a pairing between different flavors. Okay, and so you can have a pairing between U-quark and S-quark, for example. But because S-quarks are massive, the film surface has some discrepancy. Okay, and so this produces some pressure to break Cooper pairing. And that pressure, the pressure strength is of course proportional to the strain quark mass. And that pressure is comparable to the gap energy. Okay. That's a good point. Actually, nobody knows the precise value of the gap energy,
right.
But using some model, for example, you can give some estimate, and the reasonable estimate is the 10 MeV. Okay, and then that 10 MeV is comparable to the MS squared divided by the core chemical potential. That is also a 10 MeV. And so, okay, one force that tends to break Cooper pairing and one force that tends to form Cooper pairing, they are completely comparable, okay? And so that makes the ground state structure very, very complicated. And then the most likely candidate for the ground state in this region is a crystalline parasuperconducting phase, but this is crystal, okay? So, you know, the crystal analysis is very complicated, okay? Because you cannot have rotational symmetry, but you know, anyway, so this is very complicated stuff. And that's why many people left from this field, okay?
Left this field.
Yeah, so, yeah, actually, there used to be a lot of people working on color superconductivity, but nowadays, essentially, no people. Anyway, so the problem, okay, there are lots of problems remaining in this region, but the problem is that all remaining problems are too difficult, okay? Anyway, so that is a story.
The same level of kind of universality as you were dealing with IPC, kind of like ground space for the high temperature.
Well, okay. The problem is that in condensed matter physics systems, you can use experimental data
to give.
So this is anyways a tough subject. Okay. Anyway, so the QCD phase transitions that I want to address in my lecture essentially are two things. One is the deconfinement phase transition, and the other one is the higher symmetry distillation. Okay? And there may be some other phase transition, but I will, like color superconductivity, but I will not cover this. Okay, but just the deconfinement and higher distillation in this region. Okay, and so what is deconfinement? Okay, the deconfinement is very easy to understand intuitively. Okay, but as I will explain later. The field theoretical description is very subtle. Okay? But anyway, on the intuitive level, it is almost obvious. Okay? In the vacuum, the quarks and gluons are confined inside of color singlet cavern. So you cannot see any color degrees of freedom in the vacuum. But once the temperature becomes high enough, such that the interparticle distance is comparable to the, this interparticle distance must be characterized by the temperature or density, right? And if this interparticle distance is comparable to the hadron size, that is a 1 femtometer, that is again characterized by the lambda QCD. Okay, lambda QCD is 200 MeV, as I said. And 200 MeV is almost a 1 femtometer inverse, right? And so, if the temperature is something of order of this, okay, lambda QCD, then you can imagine that hadrons must have overlap with each other. And then it doesn't make sense to talk about a clear edge of individual hadrons. But they must have overlap with each other, and then the quarks can hop from one hadron to another hadron, and so on. So this edge doesn't have any clear meaning, but this whole system must be some big system of quarks and gluons, okay? Rather than the system of hadrons. And that is a sort of a population transition, okay? And this population is nothing but the deconfinement, and then you can see the liberation of the confined higher degrees of freedom. Okay? And the Cayley symmetry restoration is a little bit more complicated to understand on the intuitive level, but actually, in condensed matter physics system like solid or the metals, okay, you know that electrons must have some mass, effective mass, that is different from the vacuum mass. Okay, the electron mass is of course 511 kV, right? But in the vacuum, but inside of the metal, it must have some effective mass that is different from the vacuum mass. And in the same way, in the QCD vacuum, the quarks must have some different mass from the vacuum value. Okay, so in the vacuum or in the Lagrangian, the quarks, the U quark and the D quarks are very light, and their mass at most a few MeV, okay, 5 MeV or 3 MeV or something. But in the vacuum, we know that, for example, the protons are very massive, and the proton mass is almost 1 GeV. Okay, 940 something, right? And the proton, and the, sorry, 938, yes. And the neutron is 939. Anyway, so it is quite natural to imagine that the one quark must have a mass something like 1/3 of the proton mass or neutron mass. That means 300 something, right? So this is significantly heavier than the bare quark mass appearing in the Lagrangian. Okay, so in the vacuum, in QCD vacuum, the quarks must have some interaction clouds and having some effective mass that is a much greater than the current quark mass in the Lagrangian. But at high temperature, because of the asymptotic freedom, the interaction becomes weaker and weaker, and then at some point, these interaction clouds are gone. Okay? And then the quark mass becomes this non-perturbative value to perturbative value. Okay? That is a very natural anticipation, right? And then, so that is nothing but the chiral phase transition, okay? So, this is an intuitive explanation. And so, let's go to the confinement and deconfinement first, okay? And as I said, the confinement is a very subtle notion in Noetherian gauge theory. So naively, you may expect the following scenario, okay? If you have some charge in some theory, okay, not necessarily parallel charge or electric charge, but some charge in some theory, and if non-zero or value of this charge cannot be seen by some reason in the physical set, okay, that can be represented by this condition, then you can say that this charge is confined, right? And that is the case, or this description can make sense if it is in QED. Right? Because this charge is gauge invariant quantity, you can write down the operator, and if you take the expectation value by physical state, and if that expectation value is zero, then that means zero charge, and so you cannot see charge. Charge is confined. But in Noetherian gauge theory, this idea, simple idea, doesn't work. Why? Because this higher charge itself is not gauge invariant. Okay? This color charge is not really a physical observable. Okay? So this simple characterization doesn't work for QCD. Okay? But I will come back to this point later, because actually this description is very useful in the context of the VRS confinement scenario by Kubo and Ojima. Anyway, so the very naive idea doesn't work. Okay? So intuitively, the confinement can be understood in the following way. The excitations, elemental excitations, should be pions, or protons, or neutrons in the hadronic phase. Okay? And you cannot see any charged particles, the colored particles like quarks and gluons in this region. But if the temperature is high enough, and if you work in the deconfined phase, the fundamental excitations should be quarks and gluons. Okay? But the question is, how do you characterize this simple picture theoretically? Okay? And this is actually a very difficult. And it's naturally so, because many people talk about deconfinement phase transition. But naturally, the full understanding of deconfinement requires a full understanding of confinement physics. But of course, confinement is very difficult. Okay? If you can prove confinement mathematically, you can get $1 million, right? That is a millennium problem. Okay? So, anyway, because the intuitive understanding of confinement is so simple, you can model the confinement-deconfinement phase transition in a very simple way. Okay? So, for example, we know that in the confined phase, if you look at only low-lying hadrons, or if the temperature is at most the lambda QCD scale, 200 MeV, the only possible excitation should be pions. Okay? The protons and the neutrons are too heavy. They are 1 GeV or so, 1000 MeV, so 940. So they are too heavy, and so only pions, pi zero and pi plus minus. Okay, 3 pions can be excited. So the degrees of freedom should be 3. Okay, at most 3 plus blah blah. That is the degrees of freedom in confined phase, and on the other hand, in the deconfined phase, you have much more degrees of freedom to be excited. Namely, you have two physical polarizations for gluon. Okay, gluon is something like photon, and you know the photons have two physical polarizations. Okay, then, of course, the vector particle has four components, but only two of four are physical, and longitudinal and scalar modes are unphysical degrees of freedom. Okay, so two polarizations, and also you have 8 colors. Okay, so 16 particles, and